Welcome back, students, to my YouTube channel, Your English Teacher. Today we are going to do the line-wise explanation of the fifth chapter of Flamingo textbook for class 12. The name of the chapter is Indigo by Louis Fischer. The title Indigo actually focuses our attention on the issue of exploitation of indigo sharecroppers at the hands of cruel British planters. The British had compelled them through a long-term agreement to plant indigo on 15% of their land and surrender the entire harvest as rent. After the development of synthetic indigo by Germany, the British planters extracted money from the peasants as compensation for being released from the 15% agreement. The peasants who wanted their money back filed civil suits, and Rajkumar Shukla at that time persuaded Gandhi to take up the case of indigo sharecroppers. So indigo sharecropping exemplifies this injustice of the British and the Indians' submission to British authority. The Champaran movement that centered on indigo sharecropping led to the social and cultural upliftment of the peasants. Thus the title Indigo is very highly suggestive and appropriate. So let's go to this chapter. In the first paragraph we find that it tells about how Rajkumar Shukla was able to convince Gandhi to come and visit him and deal with the exploitation that the indigo sharecroppers were feeling at Champaran. The I in this line refers to Louis Fischer. It's a first narrative account of his experience with Gandhiji with relation to the sharecropping incident. When I visited Gandhi first in 1942 at his ashram in Sevagram in the central India, he said, "I will tell you how it happened that I decided to urge the departure of the British." It was in 1917. So the I over here refers to Louis Fischer, and here the I refers to Gandhiji. Okay? He had gone to the December 1916 annual convention of the Indian National Congress Party in Lucknow. There were 2,301 delegates and many visitors. During the proceedings, Gandhi recounted, "A peasant came up to me looking like any other peasant in India, poor and emaciated, and said, 'I am Rajkumar Shukla. I am from Champaran and I want you to come to my district.' Gandhi had never heard of this place, and it was the foothills of the towering Himalayas near the kingdom of Nepal." So here the I here becomes Rajkumar Shukla, the sharecropper who was responsible for ensuring and convincing Gandhi to come to Champaran and help all the sharecroppers and emancipate them from the landlords. Under an ancient agreement, it was a very old agreement. What was the agreement between the landlords, the British landlords, and the Indian sharecroppers? The arrangement of the Champaran peasants, which were called sharecroppers, that arrangement was a very old arrangement. Rajkumar Shukla was one of those peasants, and he was illiterate like most of them. But he was very resolute. He was very, very sure. He was determined. He showed perseverance. We can say that because he ensured that Gandhi, despite not responding to his request to come and visit Champaran immediately, despite following him across different states of the country, he ensured that Gandhiji visited Champaran. So he had come to the Congress session to complain about the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar, and somebody had probably said, "Speak to Gandhi." So he was guided or advised at that Congress session that the person who can solve this problem or contribute to the upliftment of the sharecroppers and free them, that could be done by Gandhiji. So Gandhi told Shukla he had an appointment in Kanpur, and was also committed to go to other parts of India. Shukla accompanied him everywhere. He did not lose hope. He was very perseverant. Then Gandhi returned to his ashram near Ahmedabad. Shukla followed him to the ashram. For weeks, he never left Gandhi's side. So he begged Gandhi, that is, Rajkumar Shukla begged Gandhi, fix a date. Impressed by the sharecropper's tenacity, that means he was not easily warded off, and he was very, very sure and resolute. And he was also impressed by his story. Gandhi said that I have to be in Calcutta on such and such date. Come and meet me and take me from there. Now months passed and Shukla was sitting on his haunches at the appointed spot in Calcutta where Gandhi arrived. Haunches refer to when you see some laborers sitting, the way they sit. They sit on their haunches without actually totally sitting on the floor, but at the same time sitting on the floor on their feet. So they were sitting he was sitting on his haunches at the appointed spot in Calcutta when Gandhi arrived. He waited till Gandhi was free, and then the two of them boarded a train for the city of Patna in Bihar. There Shukla led him to a house of a lawyer named Rajendra Prasad, who later became the president of the Congress Party of India. Rajendra Prasad was out of town, but the servants knew Shukla as a poor yeoman who presented their master to help the indigo sharecroppers. So they let him stay on the grounds with his companion. Gandhi, whom they took to be another peasant, but Gandhi was not permitted to draw water from the well, lest some drops of his bucket pollute the entire source. How did they know that he was not an untouchable? So we are talking about that era where untouchability was so prevalent, it was so rampant across the cities and the states, that they mistook Gandhi to be an untouchable like the sharecropper Rajkumar Shukla. And the writer, that's the narrator, Louis Fischer, is trying to defend and says that how would Rajendra Prasad's servants not know that Gandhi was not a sharecropper, was not an untouchable? Because the way Gandhi used to dress up, he used to dress up in bare minimals. And the way, the fact that he was with Rajkumar Shukla, that also it seemed as if he was also an untouchable. So they were not allowed, they were waiting outside, but they were not allowed to have water from the well even, because they believed that if some droplets of what Gandhi had, the water that Gandhi had, would fall into the well, the entire well would be polluted. Now Gandhi decided to go first to Muzaffarpur, which was en route to Champaran, that is on the route to Champaran, to obtain more complete information about conditions than Shukla was able to impart it. See, so Rajkumar Shukla was able to convince him to fight the case. Not fight the case, but even listen to them. Come and see the situation at Champaran. Come and see what was the problem that these sharecroppers were in. But he would be able to give only limited information. So Gandhiji would not take up a case without doing his own homework, and therefore he decided to find more information about the conditions of the sharecroppers, more than what Shukla was able to impart. He accordingly sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kriplani. Now these are terms you may remember, and names you may remember. He was at J.B. Kriplani, a professor at the Arts College in Muzaffarpur, whom he had seen at the Tagore's Shanti Niketan. The train arrived at midnight, and on 15 April 1917, Kriplani was waiting at the station with a large body of students. Gandhi stayed there for 2 days. So J.B. Kriplani was able to go and welcome him. But finally, Gandhi stayed at Professor Malkani's home, a teacher in the government school. Why was it an extraordinary thing at that time? Because he was a government professor. And for a government professor to harbor a man like him, it meant like actually harboring a person who was trying to infiltrate into the power that these Britishers had. Understand, he's a government professor, and therefore the government was made of Britishers. Now, if a government professor who is actually earning his bread and butter from the government, the British government, is going to help a man who is going to try to overthrow their power in their country, that would definitely be an extraordinary thing. In smaller localities, the Indians were afraid to show sympathy for the advocates of home rule. That means in smaller places, there were Indians who were very afraid to show any kind of agreement or sympathy or even show any kind of consensus with those who advocated home rule, with those who wanted to propagate home rule. And home rule meant that only Indians could rule India and the Britishers should leave. Now, if this is what Gandhiji is known for propagating, it was extraordinary for a government professor like Professor Malkani to help such a man. I'm going back to the previous slide and take up this question. Why is Rajkumar Shukla being described as resolute? He was a man with a very strong willpower and determination. He had come all the way from Champaran district to Lucknow to speak to Gandhi, and he accompanied Gandhi everywhere, from even till his ashram in Ahmedabad, till he did not give him a date to meet. For weeks he never left his side, and later it was in Calcutta that Gandhiji agreed to meet him. Why do you think the servants thought Gandhiji to be another peasant? See, Shukla took Gandhiji to Rajendra Prasad's house, and Gandhi was dressed up in a simple dhoti and was accompanied by a sharecropper and untouchable himself. So hence the servants mistook him to be a peasant, and they also forbade him to draw water from the well. But why do you think Gandhi considered the Champaran episode to be a turning point in his life? Now, if this is a short answer question, I can answer it right now. But when it comes to be a long answer question, all long answer questions should be answered in three paragraphs. And in the first paragraph, you'll talk about the general introduction, and then we'll go on to the details and then a conclusion. I am dealing with this question as a short answer question at this moment. So the Champaran episode began as an attempt to ease the sufferings of the large number of poor peasants. He got the wholehearted support of thousands of people, and Gandhiji admitted that he had done a very ordinary thing. He declared that the British could just not order him about in his own country. Hence he considered the Champaran episode as a turning point in his life. It's like saying all throughout his life Gandhiji has been advocating and propagating the aspect of home rule, and it was only at Champaran that this propagation of his, this wish of his, actually materialized, because it was at Champaran that actually the whole of the country, the whole of the village Champaran, all the peasants stood by their side. The lawyers also understood that it was right to fight against the Britishers. The whole chapter actually talks about, it revolves around the theme of the fear of revolt. Freedom from the fear of revolt. That is what the whole chapter is about. So here we were talking about how it was extraordinary for a professor to actually show some kind of concern and extend a helping hand to a person who was an advocate of home rule. Now, the news of Gandhi's advent and the nature of his mission spread very quickly through Muzaffarpur and to Champaran, and the sharecroppers from Champaran began arriving on foot and by conveyance to see their champion. They were very interested to understand who is this person who has come to fight for them. The Muzaffarpur lawyers also called Gandhiji and to brief them, and they frequently represented peasants. What did they say? They told him that they, the Muzaffarpur lawyers, frequently represented the peasant groups in the court, and they told him about their cases and reported the size of their fee. Now, Gandhiji chided the lawyers. He scolded the lawyers for collecting a big fee from the sharecroppers, because the sharecroppers already were exploited. They already were having a big problem related to money and keeping both ends meet. So he said, "I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to the law courts. Taking such cases to the courts, does little good. Where the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken, law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from the fear. So here his justification was, Gandhiji's justification was, that there's no point of taking these cases of sharecroppers to law courts which are actually being governed by Britishers themselves. And what are we doing? These poor peasants who are already so crushed and so fear-stricken, they are going to go to these British courts and going to complain against Britishers, who are the British landlords. So how do you expect the law courts to ever cite a case, judge a case in favor of the Indian poor peasants? So he said, winning the case would not be the relief. The main relief would be from freedom from the fear of revolt. As I told you, this is the main aspect, the main theme of the chapter. Gandhiji's ambition was totally different. He aimed at freedom from the fear of revolt. Okay? Most of the arable land in the Champaran district was divided into large estates owned by Englishmen and worked by Indian tenants. The chief commercial crop was indigo. This paragraph is going to explain what was the situation, what was the exploitation, why was Rajkumar Shukla so resolute in getting Gandhiji here, what was the trouble the sharecroppers were facing, how were they being exploited. This is what is explained in these paragraphs. So these estates were owned by Englishmen and they were worked on by Indian tenants. The chief commercial crop was indigo. It used to fetch a lot of money in the market. So the landlords, which were Britishers, they forced the tenants, that is the Indian sharecroppers, to plant 3/20 or say 15% of their holdings with indigo and surrender the entire indigo harvest as rent. This was done by a long-term contract. If you recall at the beginning, the writer Louis Fisher, the narrator, states that it was an ancient arrangement. This arrangement of the whole arable land being divided into 15% and the rest 85%. That was an arrangement that was going on for the last so many years. In that 15%, the sharecroppers were expected to grow indigo. Now, indigo fetched a lot of money in the market. It was a very, very fetched after crop. Now, the question is, why did the sharecroppers not grow the whole of the land with indigo, if that was the point? The reason is because when this plant would be grown in a land, it would take a lot of time for that soil to replenish its fertility. So it was definitely fetching a lot of money in the market, but the soil to replenish itself with fertility would be take a lot of months. So the farmers didn't have that kind of time, but the landlords wanted this crop. So they forced these sharecroppers that if you want this land, you can grow whatever crop you want, but 15% of the area you have to grow with indigo. So presently the land, what would be given to them as rent? The indigo harvest will be given as rent. They did not want any money like, okay, you give us say 20,000 as rent or 15,000 as rent. That fixed amount was not the rent that they had to give. The sharecroppers had to give the whole harvest as rent. So this was the arrangement between the sharecroppers and the British landlords. Then what was the problem? So what happened was, the landlords got to know that Germany had developed synthetic indigo. They thereupon obtained agreements from the sharecroppers to pay them compensation for being released from the 15% arrangement. That means that instead of the indigo harvest, now the landlord said, we want fixed amount of money instead. Because they realized that even if they get the indigo harvest, it will not fetch them money in the market. Why? Because the market had been invaded by German synthetic indigo. That indigo would fetch was actually stealing the position of the indigo harvest in the market. So even if they were given the indigo harvest as rent, the landlords would not be able to sell it off in the market because of the presence of the German synthetic indigo. So they very conveniently changed the agreement and they said instead of the 15% compensation, 15% harvest, you give us money in as compensation. The sharecropping arrangement was very irksome. It was troublesome to many peasants. Now see the reaction of this. Some of the peasants were not happy with this arrangement, the old arrangement. So they very happily signed. Now those who resisted engaged lawyers. So those who resisted, they engaged lawyers and the landlords hired thugs. Because these people wanted to know what is the reason that such an ancient arrangement is suddenly being changed. They wanted to understand because they were illiterate, so they engaged lawyers. When the landlord saw that these peasants who were not willingly signing were engaging lawyers, they wanted to scare them and they hired gundas. Now, meanwhile, the information about synthetic indigo reached the illiterate peasants who had already signed. There were many who signed willingly. They signed willingly because they had no idea about the German synthetic indigo which had invaded the market. Now, when that reached the illiterate peasants who had signed, they wanted their money back. They realized that they had been made a fool of. It was at this point that Gandhiji arrived at Champaran. This question usually is asked, when did Gandhiji, at what point in history did Gandhiji arrive in Champaran? He began by trying to get the facts and first he visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association. The secretary told him that they could give no information to an outsider and Gandhiji answered that he was no outsider. So here you need to build up a kind of a idea, a track of events, okay? And it would help if you jot it down. Number one, where did he go? He went to the secretary of the British Landlords Association. What was his treatment here? He was informed that he was an outsider and therefore no information would be shared with him. The second was he went to the British Official Commissioner of their Hood Division, which was the Champaran districts, which was in the Champaran district. Now this commissioner, he said he started to bully Gandhi. And he advised him to leave Tirhut immediately. So these were two places that Gandhiji had gone after understanding the situation of the Champaran peasants. Gandhiji did not leave. Instead, he proceeded to Motihari, and that is the capital of Champaran. There were many lawyers who accompanied him, and at the railway station, there were a number of people who gathered to meet him. He went to the house and that became the headquarters, and from there he started his investigation. Suddenly there was a report that there was a peasant who had been maltreated at a nearby village, and Gandhiji decided to go and see him. When he started on the back of an elephant, he had not proceeded very far where there was superintendent's messenger came and ordered him to return to the town in his carriage. Gandhiji complied. He said, fine. The messenger drove Gandhi home, where he served him with an official notice to quit Champaran immediately. See, Gandhi signed the receipt because it was a court order. You have to acknowledge it if you are there. But he acknowledged it, but he also wrote that I disobey the order. This was, in fact, where the confrontation with the Britishers actually started illegally. And then he was summoned to appear in the court the next day. I'll go to the previous slide. And over here, as I told you, you have to list the places that Gandhiji visited between his first meeting with Shukla and his arrival at Champaran. So this was on the first few pages. Gandhiji first met Shukla at Lucknow and he was in Kanpur. Then he was in Kanpur and other parts of India. He returned to the ashram near Ahmedabad and later he visited Calcutta, Patna, Muzaffarpur and before arriving at Champaran. What did the peasants pay the British landlords as rent? The peasants used to pay indigo, 15% harvest of indigo as rent to the British landlords. And what did the Britishers now want instead? Now see, German had invaded the market with synthetic indigo. So the British landlords wanted money as compensation for being released from the earlier ancient arrangement. The prices of natural indigo would definitely go down, so they will not be able to procure that amount of money if they sold the harvest. So they said, instead of the harvest, you give us a compensation in terms of cash, in terms of money, and therefore it would be better. Now this is what was actually troublesome for the peasants. From where would these poor people get the money when the indigo harvest is anyways not going to fetch them any money in the market? Okay, so going over here, so he was actually summoned. Now what happens at the court? All night Gandhi remained awake because he was obviously, this was something, if in case he was arrested, who would take charge of the situation at Champaran? That was what was on his mind. Who was going to fight with the for the sharecroppers? So he telegraphed Rajendra Prasad to come from Bihar with influential friends, and he sent instructions to the ashram and he wired a full report to the viceroy. Okay, morning found the town of Motihari black with peasants. That means that actually a large number of peasants had gathered here. When you look at a place from a bird's eye view and you see a huge number of people gathering together, all you see is black hair. So that's why this expression is there, black with peasants. From a bird's eye view, you would see people's head, that to hair, and that's why this expression. They did not know Gandhi's record in South Africa. They had merely heard that there was a Mahatma who wanted to help them and was in trouble with the authorities. So their spontaneous demonstration, and in thousands they came to the courthouse, and that was the beginning of their liberation from the fear of the Britishers. This is very important because the very fact that they collected in numbers to speak against a ruling authority, this was the first instance where they stood up together in numbers to speak against the Britishers. The officials felt very powerless without Gandhi's cooperation. He helped them regulate the crowd. Had Gandhi not helped them regulate the crowd, the officials would not have been able to control the crowd. He was polite and friendly. Gandhiji was very polite and friendly. He was giving them concrete proof that their might, hitherto dreaded and unquestioned, could be challenged by Indians. He was giving them means the British officials, concrete proof, concrete evidence, simple, plain, unchallenging evidence that their might refers to the officials' might, their might refers to the Britishers' might. Hitherto is till now, their might, till now the strength and the might of the Britishers was dreaded, was feared, and was unquestioned. Now it could be challenged by Indians. This very episode, which showed that the officers could not control the crowd, whereas Gandhiji could control the crowd, was a proof, a concrete proof that the Britishers' might and control till now, which was feared and unquestioned, could obviously be questioned now by these Indians. So this was an example of Gandhiji's influence over the masses. The government was baffled. It was confused. It didn't know what to do. The prosecutor requested the judge to postpone the trial. Apparently the authorities wished to consult their superiors. So they wanted to consult their superiors. That means even the East India Company sitting maybe in London. So Gandhi protested against the delay. He sensed the situation. He knew that these people, the government officials, could not punish him and put him in jail, because if they did, then who would control the masses? And if they did not, then also it would be a kind of a loss. How would they save their face? he read a statement pleading guilty. He said, I'm guilty, you punish me. But somehow he knew that Gandhiji knew, somehow he knew that these officials could not punish him. Because look at the number of crowds which they could not control without his help. So he was involved, he said. He told to the court, I'm involved in a conflict of duties. On the one hand, not to set a bad example as a lawbreaker, and on the other hand, to render the humanitarian and national service for which he had come. So he was in a conflict of duties. He was in a dilemma. What to do? On one hand, if he doesn't obey the law, he would set an example of being a lawbreaker. He did not want to set that example because in near future there is a possibility that if India rules the country, what will, and then there are lawbreakers, then Gandhiji's episode could be cited. He could become an example of a lawbreaker. He did not want to do that. And on the other hand, if he did not break the law, he would not be able to render, give, show humanitarian and national service. What is a humanitarian and national service? It was that he should help these sharecroppers and free them from the clutches of the British landlords for which he had come. Okay, this was the reason he had come here. He had come here to render humanitarian and national service. Now, he disregarded the order to leave. Remember over here, he disobeyed the order. He disregarded the order to leave, not for want. Want means lack. Lack of respect for lawful authority. He did not disagree or disregard or show disrespect to the court's order for lack of respect for the court. But he showed that he would disagree with the order to leave because he was obeying a higher law. And what was that higher law? It was the higher law of existence, the higher law of his conscience. His conscience did not allow him to desert, to leave these sharecroppers who were in misery and who were being tormented and maltreated and exploited by the British landlords. So he displayed a disregard to the court order by signing that he would disobey the order, because it was not because he did not have any respect for the law, but it was because he wanted to render service to his voice of conscience. His conscience did not allow him to desert the sharecroppers. He said, I'm guilty, you punish me. I am guilty, and what am I guilty of? I am guilty that I am actually involved in a conflict of duties. And he asked the penalty due. He said, you give me the punishment. Now the magistrate announced that he would pronounce sentence after a 2-hour recess and asked Gandhi to furnish bail for 120 minutes. Gandhi said, no, I don't want to ask for bail. Then the judge released him without bail. So see the influence, the negotiation skills of Gandhi over here. He could understand the pulse of the masses. He could understand the pulse of the landlords and the Britishers at this point of time. When the court reconvened, the judge said he would not deliver the judgment for several days. Meanwhile, he allowed Gandhi to remain at liberty. So they could not muster up the courage of delivering a judgment against Gandhi. So Gandhi was free to remain without any charges till further any intimation. So Rajendra, now he was free, but they had to plan. So Rajendra Prasad, Brij Kishore Babu, Maulana Mazrul Haq and several other prominent lawyers had arrived from Bihar, and they had a conference with Gandhi, and they were discussing what would they do if he was sentenced to prison, and Gandhiji asked them. So one of the senior lawyers said that they had come to advise and help him, and if Gandhiji is going to go end up in jail, there would be nobody else to advise, and therefore they all would go home. Now, Gandhiji was very surprised at this and he said, what about the injustice to the sharecroppers? If I end up in jail, who's going to take care of the sharecroppers? The battle will be lost even before it has started to fight. The lawyers withdrew to consult. They went to another room and then Rajendra Prasad recorded the upshot of their consultations. Because remember, this is all being written by Louis Fischer. Louis Fischer might have got in touch with Rajendra Prasad and must have recorded what was the talk that they had when they were chided and scolded. They were questioned by Gandhi here. They thought amongst themselves that Gandhi was only a stranger and yet he was prepared to go to prison for the sake of peasants. If they, on the other hand, being not only residents of the adjoining districts but also those who claim to have served these peasants, should go home, it would definitely be a shameful desertion. Desertion here refers to you are deserting the sharecroppers to fight for their, fend for their own. So they came up with a plan and they said that we are definitely going to follow him into jail. It was at this point that Gandhiji said the battle of Champaran is won. Why did he say this? At what point of time did he say this? This is usually a question that is asked. Why did he say this? Because he realized that now people, even affluent people, people who are better off than these sharecroppers, they are able to show empathy. They are able to treat this exploitation and problem of the sharecroppers as their own. So they all are going to stand up for the well-being of the sharecroppers. He exclaimed. Then he took a piece of paper and divided the group into pairs and put down the order in which each pair was to go to court arrest. So in pairs they will go and subject themselves to, submit themselves to court, to the jail. Several days later, Gandhiji received a written communication from the magistrate informing him that the lieutenant governor of the province had ordered the case to be dropped. Civil disobedience had finally triumphed the first time in the modern India. That was very important. Civil disobedience means that a huge number of people, the masses, have decided not to obey the government. And it was this civil disobedience, non-cooperation movement, all these two major agendas, movements that actually helped India to gain her freedom. So this was, remember, Gandhiji was free over here. He was not punished for not agreeing to leave Champaran. So they could not muster up the courage because of the kind of support Gandhiji had. So it was the first time that civil disobedience had triumphed, and Gandhiji and the lawyers now proceeded. So now they were free. Okay. Now Gandhiji did not sit back. He and his lawyers started collecting all kind of notes and evidences from 10,000 peasants, and it was written down. And he therefore prepared all the papers before Gandhiji was summoned to Sir Edward Gate, the lieutenant governor. And before he went, he met the leading associates and again they laid a detailed plan for civil disobedience in case he should not return. What was that civil disobedience? That two of them in pairs would submit themselves in jail. Now, Gandhi had four protracted interviews with the lieutenant governor, who as a result appointed an official committee of inquiry, SIT Bithadi, into the Indigo sharecropper situation. The commission consisted of landlords, government officials, and Gandhi as the sole representative of the peasants. So there were three representatives. Now, Gandhi remained in Champaran for an initially uninterrupted period of 7 months and then again for several shorter visits. The visit undertaken casually on the entreaty of an unlettered peasant. Who was an unlettered peasant? Here it refers to Rajkumar Shukla. And who entreaty? It was a casual visit that was a result of a request of an unlettered peasant, that was Rajkumar Shukla, in the expectation that it would last a few days, accompanied almost a year of Gandhi's life. So actually he was supposed to go there and listen to the queries and the problems of the sharecroppers, and once that would be solved, he would have gone back. But actually this short visit, which was a result of a request of an unlettered peasant, that is Rajkumar Shukla, took almost a year of Gandhi's life. Okay? So the official inquiry, it assembled a crushing mountain of evidence against the big planters. When the landlords, the big planters refer to the British landlords, when they saw this, they agreed that they would make refunds to the peasants, but how much should they pay? And Gandhiji, they thought, would ask for full repayment. But actually, that was not what Gandhiji did. He asked for 50%. There he seemed adamant. And then, thinking that probably he would not give away, the representative of the planters offered to refund to the extent of 25% only. So what was the idea behind Gandhiji agreeing to 25%? There were many who expected him to ask for 100%. Many thought that at 50% he would be very adamant, but he was okay with even 25%. He explains in this paragraph, Louis Fischer explains what was Gandhi's point of view in this paragraph, and he says, for Gandhi, the amount of money was never important. Getting the amount of money for once was never going to fulfill the actual issue related to Champaran. He wanted the peasants to understand that this was their fight for freeing themselves from the fear of revolt. And the amount of money not being important, the gesture of agreeing that they had done wrong, the gesture of parting away with their money, was also symbolic of the fact that they had parted away from their prestige. Who is they here? The British landlords. So the very fact that they agreed to the fact that they had maltreated and exploited the sharecroppers was more important than the amount of money that they had to part with. So these lines here are very important. Gandhi explained that the amount of refund was less important than the fact that the landlords had been obliged to surrender part of their money and with it part of their prestige. Therefore, as far as the peasants were concerned, the planters had behaved as lords above law. That means they had behaved in such a manner that nobody could question them. They were even above law. Now the peasants saw that he too had rights. He too had people who would defend him. He too learned courage. As I told you, this whole chapter is about a lesson freeing the peasants, the illiterate, the subjugated, the exploited, from the freedom, free them from the fear of revolt. Now, events justified his position. Which events justified Gandhi's position? Within few years, the British planters abandoned their estates, which reverted to the peasants. Indigo sharecropping disappeared. Okay, Gandhi never contented himself with largely political or economical solutions. He saw the cultural and social backwardness in the Champaran villages and wanted to do something about it immediately. He appealed for the teachers and all these people from everywhere, Mahadev Desai, Narhari Parekh, even his own son Devdas and his wife had come all the way to engage themselves in the cultural and social upliftment of Champaran. Okay, Kasturba Gandhi taught the ashram rules and personal cleanliness and community sanitation. So once even, you can see till here, he had solved the solution of the sharecroppers. But he did not leave Champaran immediately. He spent another 1.5 years almost at Champaran trying to uplift them culturally and socially so that they never ever think of falling into this trap again, and they always gather the courage to voice out their opinion and their their refusal to be subjugated. So he dealt with the health conditions over here. Earlier, there were only three medicines which would deal with masses that had either malaria or tuberculosis or any other such skin eruptions. So these were generally given according to these problems. Gandhiji also noted the filthy state of women's clothes, and Kasturba Gandhi guided those people. Then in his long stay in Champaran, he also kept a long distance watch on the ashram. He sent regular instructions by mail and asked for financial accounts. From there only he managed all that. Then we can see that the Champaran episode actually became a turning point in his life. What he did was actually a very ordinary thing. He declared the Britishers could not order him about in his own country. That's what he did over here. So it was a turning point in his life, because all his life he had been working for establishing a strong footing of Indians in their very own country and driving the Britishers out of the country. But Champaran did not begin as an act of defiance. It grew out as of an act to alleviate, raise out the distress of large number of poor peasants. And ultimately, it turned out to be a turning point in his life. It did not start with this mission in mind, but it was for freeing the sharecroppers from the exploitation of the landlords. Now, in everything Gandhiji did, he tried to mold a new free Indian who would stand on his own feet and thus make India free. So it was a lesson in self-reliance as well. It was a lesson Indian independence. It was a lesson to ensure all the sharecroppers would always speak against any injustice. Now, in this paragraph, we'll find that the lawyers had advised Gandhiji to take Charles Freer Andrews under his wing. He was an English pacifist and he was a devotee of Mahatma. The idea behind that was that if we have a Britisher on our side, then we will be able to fight for our rights with much more ease against Britishers. Now, this is what Gandhiji understood, that this is what they were thinking about. And he said that you think it is an unequal fight? It would be helpful if we have an Englishman on our side. This shows the weakness of your heart. The cause is just and you must rely upon yourselves to win the battle. You should not seek a prop in Mr. Andrews because he happens to be an Englishman. So do not look for assistance. Do not look for any kind of support in an Englishman because you are fighting against English landlords and the British government. You have to have a faith in yourself. You have to be self-reliant. You have to understand India is your country. You have to understand you need to gain freedom from the fear of revolt. All this was actually bound together. In Champaran, we can see that actually he had woven lessons of self-reliance, Indian independence, and freedom from the fear of revolt, all in one. So children, I hope you've understood the chapter. And in the next video, we will be dealing with only text questions. Then there will be another video which will talk about only short answer questions. And then one more video that will talk about only long answer questions. I really hope you benefit from this session. So children, please do visit these videos. They will definitely help you in preparation for your board exams, your home exams. And if there is any query, please leave a comment below. Subscribe to the channel and I'll try to answer your queries in the comments below as well. Thank you so much.